You're in a better place, I've heard a thousand times. And at least a thousand times, I've rejoiced for you. But the reason why I'm broken, the reason why I cry, is how long must I wait to be with you? I close my eyes and I see your face. If home's where my heart is, then I'm out of place. Lord, won't you give me strength to make it through somehow? I've never been more homesick than now. I don't understand your ways. The reason why I wonder if I'll ever know. But even if you showed me, the hurt would be the same. 'Cause I'm still here, so far away from home. I close my home's where my heart is, then I'm out of place. Lord, won't you give me strength to make it through somehow? I've never been more homesick than now. In Christ, there are no goodbyes.
Tell him all about the man that I became, and hope that it pleased him. There's so much I want to say, there's so much I want you to know. When I finally in my steps, and all the questions that I swore I would ask were
answers won't come yet. I'm so amazed in what I've seen, so much more than this old mind can hold. When I finally make it home, when I finally make it home, and the sweetest sound these ears have yet to hear, the voices of the angels.
Please stand. You may all be seated. On behalf of Lakewood United Methodist Church and the Howell Hecker family, I'd like to welcome you all here to join in the celebration of Bradley's life. My name is Pastor Trish Woodruff. I'm one of the associate pastors here, and it's always an honor for me when I have the privilege of officiating and celebrating the life of one of our saints, because it is a time that we remember that in dying, Christ destroyed our death. In rising, Christ restored our life, and that Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Bradley put on Christ. And so as he is now in Christ, may Bradley be clothed in glory. Here and now, dear friends, let us remember that we are all God's children. We are all to be clothed in glory. And what we shall be has not yet been revealed. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. And those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He or she who believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, forevermore, I am alive. And I hold the keys to hell and death. And because I live, you shall live also.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I got lost in the lie that it was up to me to make a name the world remembers. But Jesus is the only name to remember. And I don't wanna leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus. And
find our bulletin and go to the last page. Together, we are going to say a psalm that most of you are probably familiar with, a psalm that brings comfort, a psalm that reminds us that God is with us, Psalm 23. And we will say it all together in unison. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Friends, we have gathered here together to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Bradley Philip Heilhecker. We come together acknowledging our grief in such a human loss. We ask that God might grant us grace, that in pain we find comfort, in our sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. One of the ways that we cope with our grieving and our sadness, as well as one of the ways that we celebrate life, is to continue to tell stories. And one of Bradley's good friends, John, is here to share some memories about Brad and the times that they had together. Thank you, John, for being willing to share that.
Thank you for being here on behalf of Brad, his family. It's so great to see this group here. I live in College Station, and I'm so thrilled to be able to be part of this celebration of Brad's life. I thank you for your love for Brad, his family, his friends, co-workers. Thank you for loving Brad. And I'd like particularly to extend a thanks to Kathy and Tom for caring for Brad at the end of his life, before the beginning of his life. I have the privilege of standing here before you to share a few things about Bradley Philip Heilhecker, whom I call Brad, my dear friend and my brother in Christ, whom I believe I will enjoy seeing much more of in the life to come. I realize your relationship with Brad is unique. Mine may have some things in common with yours. Regardless, I hope all of us have memories of Brad that we can treasure forever. Speaking of which, you might notice at the end of the pews, there may be a DVD video that is for you to pick up. And that includes a couple of songs of Brad's that he shared with my wife and me, and then an interview on the DVD of Brad about his life. And it was done in July of 2014, 2 weeks after he was diagnosed with cancer. Those are available for you to pick up. And there's also flash drives with the movie on it. And I hope you'll enjoy that. And also, I believe Kathy's going to post the link to the YouTube video, the same video, on her business website. My wife, Elise, and I met Brad around 1984 through mutual friends, as we were all actively involved at Grace Bible Church and the Singles Fellowship in College Station. Brad's most notable attributes throughout the years were his authenticity, his transparency, his honesty, and his earnestness, which can be defined as sincere and intense conviction. Did anybody see his earnestness over the years? He had a great ability to overcome with God's help, and he was humble. A friend shared part of a devotion with me about transparency. It says, part of it says, truly transparent, not hiding anything, I am at my holiest, not deceiving or pretending to be something I am not, but acknowledging honestly my uncertainty and my pain. That was Brad much of the time during our friendship, authentic and transparent. Brad was also very honest about his life with me, his past, his present, his hopes and thoughts for the future. Brad was a good listener, which helps for those of us who are big talkers like me. And he offered me a safe friendship to share my life with him. His intense focus during his life after placing his faith in Christ as Lord and Savior was to know Christ and to make him known. He was intense but approachable, serious, yet he could enjoy himself. He loved God's word, studied it, and shared it with others. He wrote over 100 worship songs. He emailed devotional blog writings, over 300 in the latter years of his life, which his good friend Michelle Ballum compiled in a book called Sterling Wisdom. And I believe there's also books available for you to pick up at the end of the pews. Please grab a book if you can. They're wonderful, wonderful, insightful, and I think inspired writings. You can also buy the book or recommend it to somebody to buy on Amazon. Brad was like a prophet crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God." His consistent spiritual focus reminded me of a mockingbird lately that has been singing early in the morning by our home in College Station during the night. Two nights ago, it was from 3 to 6 a.m. This morning, he was singing away at 6 a.m. And that reminds me a lot of Brad, who authentically lived his song of life before others. And whenever I see a mockingbird now or hear them sing, I tend to think of Brad. A story for you. One year, Brad and another friend and I traveled to South Fork, to the cabin in South Fork, to stay for several days to have our own spiritual retreat. While there, we met regularly to discuss a book we were all reading. And we enjoyed hiking, enjoyed the river, and we enjoyed the hot springs and Pagosa Springs. A nice combination of knowing Christ, fellowship with one another, and having fun. Brad was a great and earnest host. By the way, for those of you who knew Brad well, can you imagine the conversations we had in the car going up to Colorado and back? Never a dull moment, as my grandmother used to say. I know there are many stories about Brad which you have, and I hope you'll share them with others to celebrate his life in the days and weeks and months to come. Let's not forget Brad. Brad was an overcomer. We all have painful, before being an overcomer, I wanted to share another incident regarding Brad's spiritual sensitivity. When I was visiting him here in Houston, and I was at his apartment, he was getting ready to leave that day, and I noticed Brad has a routine that he goes through. He went through at the apartment, and it made him feel more comfortable. He checked everything, and the big thing I noticed is he got down on his hands and knees, and he prayed at his easy chair. He put his head in the easy chair, and he prayed about the day, but most importantly, he said, "God, when do you want me to go?" And I thought, you know, you got to say, who does that? But I thought, that's not a bad idea. So I took note of that. And by the way, the photo of Brad praying that day is in the DVD, pictures with the video and all. So Brad was an overcomer. We all have painful events in our lives. Some have health conditions, family struggles, relationship struggles, personal struggles. Brad has had his what we might call arrows to the heart as well. With God's help, Brad not only coped with his arrows, his trials, but overcame them. He took advantage of the blessing of the support of his family, his friends, and fellow strugglers. He so often, and by the way, also with the support of the local churches and home churches, he so often exhibited a calm, courageous, confidence. And he didn't complain much. I often wondered if his confidence was real or not. And you know what? I think it was. He seemed to adopt a passage in Joshua chapter 1 that says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. The Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Brad was humble. Psalm 27:8 reminds me of Brad's heart, his humble heart. "Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, I seek." Brad wrote this about humility on page 41 of his book, Sterling Wisdom. "So we think of ourselves with sober judgment, according to the measure of faith that we have been given. We consider others better than ourselves, and we humbly submit our lives and our cares to our most gracious and loving Heavenly Father. Surely this is our pathway to peace with God and man." This passage below reflects Brad. "I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord." Another one, final verse I'll share with you is in Psalm 27, 13, 14. "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man and woman and child, of course, who takes refuge in him." And now, finally, I want to leave you an image to take with you, and that is from the movie Dances with Wolves. I don't know if anyone saw that years ago. It was a popular movie with Kevin Costner, who portrayed a lieutenant from the Union Army who went to live with the Sioux Indians. And he grew to understand them, to care for them and love them. And over time, they grew to accept him and love him. And there's a scene toward the end of the movie when he's leaving with his wife, who he married from the Sioux tribe, that is a long story, took her with him, and as they were riding, he looked up, and up on the cliff up here, just like up where these stained glass windows are, a Sioux warrior, a great Sioux warrior called Wind in His Hair, looked down upon Lieutenant Dunbar as he rode out of the village. And he yelled down at Dunbar, whose name Dances with Wolves. The Indians gave him the name Dances with Wolves. And he said, "Dances with Wolves, do you see that I am your friend?" And he held up his spear. "Do you see that I am your friend? Can you see that you will always be my friend?" And this reminds me of Brad, because back around 1990, he looked at me one day and said, "John, I think we'll be friends for life." And I thought, well, that'd be nice. You know, that'd really be nice if we could, if we would. But we all know friends sometimes come in and out of our lives, and some are there for a lifetime. Well, thanks to a large part to Brad's love and faithfulness, we were friends from 1984 on. And I am so grateful for his friendship, the ways he encouraged me, listened to me, discussed very important, heavy subjects with me, and model the life of pursuit of God. And there's this passage, I forgot, there's one more. John 15, "I no longer call you servants," Jesus said, "because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you." And I think that's what much of Brad's life was about, trying to hear from God the Father, walk with Jesus, be sensitive to the Holy Spirit, and share that with the world. Brad's friendship and his godly attributes were such a blessing in my life. I'm so thankful. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And thank you, Brad.
Thank you, John. May we all be like mockingbirds. The story, telling the good news. Well, we're going to continue to read from Scripture, some of Brad's favorite scriptures. We're going to begin with Proverbs 27. As the water reflects the face, so one's life reflects the heart. Death and destruction are never satisfied, and neither are human eyes. The crucible for silver and the furnace for gold. But people are tested by their praise. And in Hebrews 10, verses 19 to 25. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us by the curtain that is by his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us now draw near to God with a sincere heart and a full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more you see the day approaching. And last, another proverb from chapter 17, verses 3 and 17. The crucible for silver and the furnace for gold, but God tests the heart. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for a time of adversity. These are all God's rich word for all of us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Tell him that I miss him. And tell him all about the man that I became. And hope that it pleased him. There's so much I want to say. There's so much I want you to know. When I finally make it home, when I finally make it home, and then I gaze upon the throne of the King, frozen in my steps. questions that I swore I would ask. Words just won't come yet. I'm so amazed at what I've seen. So much more than this own mind can hold. When I finally make it home, when I finally make it home, and the sweetest sound these ears have yet to of the angels.
We're going to read from the gospel now, the gospel of John, John 15, which I know that John, who just spoke, mentioned a verse in John 15. And so for our sermon today, our devotional, I chose John 15, 5 to 8, where Jesus is speaking to his disciples. This is his last time with his disciples. And so he wants to have this intimate talk with him. And he tells them, he says, I am the vine and you are the branches. And those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit. Because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, and you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the gospel for all of us today to hear this message. Thanks be to God. Father, I thank you for this opportunity where we can come and celebrate Brad's life. And Lord, that we can hear from you. I pray, Lord, that we will have eyes to see and ears to hear what you would have us to learn today from you and from the example of our brother who has gone on to sainthood. We thank you, Lord, and pray that you speak through me and even in spite of me. Amen. In Brad's book that you will pick up, he says this. He says, the fruit we bear for the glory of the Father is not a result of our noble efforts. It is mysteriously a result of Christ's work in our heart, the soil that he prepared beforehand for the nurturing of the seed that he implanted his spirit. We know that God wants us to live fruitful lives, glorifying to him, but often the pathway is dimly lit. The how-to of bearing fruit is often obscured by the lure of city lights. That's so profound. To be clear, we all have our different city lights, don't we? What they might be in our lives. To be clear, we have a daily choice to build up our own reputation in our own kingdom, or to invest ourselves in God's reputation and God's kingdom. If we choose the latter, his reward is in our eternal life. And he gives us John 17, that you shall know the only true God and Jesus Christ, whom he has sent. Those are wise words from Brad. And I think that we see a testimony that we've heard about and we're going to continue to hear about how he truly invested. He invested in the reputation of God and in the kingdom of God. I think that in what people think about God, I think he invested also in what other people think about God. Not only his reputation, you know, with people liking God, he wanted everybody to love God the way that he loved him. Or maybe he said he wants even to, maybe he wants them to think about him for the first time. Maybe he wants to know his love. But this was Brad's mission. Can we just say that Bradley Philip Heilhecker was a big investor in all of this? He was an enthusiastic investor. He was willing to put all his chips in on the table for God's reputation. What were his chips? What were his investments? It was his gift of music. It was his love of people, his eloquent and challenging writing that he has left with us. He invested all of these things in the market of long-term eternal results. Seldom do we meet people in our daily life that have such a single-minded focus, not just for maybe a small period of time and then go about other things, but Bradley had this everyday single focus in his life to bring God glory and to be an investor of that. It's almost as if he woke up every morning, and I love how John said this because I wrote this last night. It's almost like he woke up every morning and asked God, okay, how do you want me to bring you glory today? Just like he knelt by his recliner and said, tell me when I should leave. And then once he heard from God, he went to work investing himself in God's reputation. Not his, but in God's reputation. Not marginally, not when it was just convenient for him, not when he just felt good about it. No, even throughout his cancer, every day, Brad was all in, investing all that he had for the one that he longed to glorify. In Mark 12, when one of the Jewish leaders asked Jesus, of all the commandments, what is the greatest commandment? Well, Jesus uses the verse in Deuteronomy, but he says it so succinctly and right away, immediately, that we cannot deny it. He says, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And the second is to love your neighbor as you love yourself. This was Bradley's investment strategy, I believe. There's no blurriness about it. No hot and cold, maybe from one day to the other. Not any huge moral quagmires about conflicting issues going on in his life. It was direct. Maybe the biggest dilemma Bradley ever had is, should I write a song today about God that glorifies him? Or should I write devotional, encouraging others in their walk with God? And of course, this is all in between his talking to people to encourage them, telling them about with what the word of God says or might have in store for them that day. Investing himself in God's kingdom was a full-time ministry for Brad. Yeah, I don't know about you, but productivity is a big thing right here. I don't know. I was going to look on up in Google how many books have been written on productivity. I don't know about y'all, but I long to be more productive. And I think everybody I know, I meet as a pastor, if I meet with people in my office, I would say the majority of people who come into my office want to talk about the purpose of their life. Everyone wants to have their life have meaning. This God put this in our hearts. We desire for our lives to have purpose and meaning and to count for something. In scripture that we just read earlier, Jesus tells us the first step to this is what he told us in scripture, in the gospel, that living our lives so closely, abiding in God so closely that we are one, that so closely that we are in lockstep with Jesus. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit. Of all of us who are here today, there's probably I'm going to say not many, maybe one or two, who have the same gifts that Bradley have, the gift of music, the gift of writing, the gift of evangelism, that spiritual gift of evangelism, and just in sanctification that he had of teaching other people. We all have different gifts. Yet we all have the same responsibility to those words of Jesus, to continually seek him, to abide in him, and to bear the kind of fruit that gives Jesus a reputation as a savior, a healer, as the giver of grace, as the one who personifies love with his nail-scarred hands. These words teach me something today, as I hope they do you as well, because I have to ask myself, how often am I more worried about my reputation than God's reputation? How much am I more worried about my popularity? Because I'll just say, sometimes that being a pastor, sometimes you're not really popular at times. I'm just going to say that. You know, we're all being honest here, you know? So, yeah, I find myself, oh, my gosh, you know, worrying if I made too many people mad. You know, am I really bearing fruit for eternity? I think it's a question we all have to continually ask here. How much to weigh? How much do we worry about our reputation, what people think of us, versus after spending time, more so than after we spend time with a person, what do they think about God? There was so much more than words written on the page for Bradley, because we can see how he lived them. We can also see how he died by them. Absolute trust in Jesus tells us that he knows who the way, the truth, and the life truly is, because he lived it. So as we come here today, we have gratitude for this life of Bradley Philip Hecker. Gratitude for helping us, for teaching us, and gratitude for loving people, loving God, and using that love to love people so well. Yet it is so understandable that along with that gratitude, we bring our grief. Because when we love somebody deeply, we also grieve deeply. How can we not? It doesn't mean that we have little faith if we're still grieving his friendship here on earth. So I want to ask you to continue telling stories about Brad, funny ones, embarrassing ones, the ones maybe that nobody knows or maybe people have heard before, who knows. But continue to tell those stories and laugh and learn from them, because Bradley still has something to teach us. Tell the poignant ones. Tell the ones that stick with you. And let us all remember to thank God continually for the blessing that he was to all of us. Yes, we are grieving today. But because we have hope, we also celebrate our faith because of that hope. We remember that in 2 Corinthians 5:17, Paul tells us, when we are absent from the body, we are present with the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? One of the biggest evangelists of all times, D.L. Moody, said, one day you will read that Moody is dead, but don't you believe that for one moment, because I will be more alive than ever before. And I just think, since Brad loved worship so much, I can just imagine how beside himself he must be to be worshiping in the very presence of the God that he loved with all of his heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I can just imagine Brad hearing from God, saying, thank you. Thank you, my good and faithful servant. Thank you for investing in my reputation with my people. Thank you for investing in my kingdom. I can't wait to show you the returns that you have on that investment. They're miraculous. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will you pray with me? Holy God, before you our hearts are open, and from you no secrets are hidden. You, our Heavenly Father, gave us birth and breath, and you're ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask. And so we come to you today with grateful hearts for the life of Bradley. We come to you as his creator and his redeemer. Give us now your grace that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Remind us of your love that is stronger than death and your passion, which is more fierce than the grave. We rejoice you and praise you for the life of Bradley, whom you have drawn into your eternal embrace. We thank you for the love he shared with so many in this room. Shine your perpetual light upon him and grant him your peace. Bring the comfort that only you can bring to this precious family and all of these wonderful friends. Be with all of them in the days ahead. When things are difficult, I pray, Lord, that they put their trust in you. May they lean into your goodness, into your grace, and your love. Strengthen our faith to believe that which we have not yet seen, but look forward to one day. We pray all of these things together in the words that Jesus taught us, which you will find in your bulletin on the opposite page of the worship. We pray this in the name of our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Right. shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
I want to thank you again for being here today, especially to bring comfort and to be a presence for this family. And thank you for testifying to the life of Bradley. As I pray our last prayer and benediction over us, I want to just tell you a few different things. Don't forget the blessing of the book and the DVD that are there for you. I know the family really wants to make sure that those gifts get taken by all of you. They're a blessing. I've already been gifted with them. And as you heard, I even used Brad's words in our message today. Also, the family will be out. As you're walking out, they'll be out the doors to the left on our little pavilion there, a little pathway. So if you want to greet them, you may go outside and to meet them. Our ushers will show you out right after. I will pray. And then we are also going to have a last little bit of worship from Brad himself in the video. And as we play that, I'd like us all to think about how when we worship, we're actually worshiping with all the saints in heaven. And so, yes, we might see Bradley, you know, having y'all, you and John, y'all, you, this was recording for a while, a few years ago. But Bradley is now, as well as all the saints, are worshiping in heaven as we worship here today. So let's remember that promise. Lord, we thank you that your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still God. We thank you for your faithfulness. We come to you with open hands to take the blessings of life as well as the difficult places. We need more of you. Open our hearts to receive all that you have in store for us. May we abide in your goodness and your grace. And to those of us who doubt, give light. To those of us who are weak, strength. To those of us who have sinned, mercy. To those of us who are in grief, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. Help us to trust you in all of our ways. May our gratitude for Bradley overflow into peace. Peace, because we live in the promise of your resurrection and eternal life. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hi, everybody. This is the Henry Retreat, July 9th at the Henry Home and College Station. And we're going to sing three worship songs that we've practiced for you this weekend. One is God Speaking to Us, Be Still and Know That I Am God. The other one is Our Prayer to God, Back to Him is Lord, Grant Now a Restful Spirit. And the last one, the third one, is a longer one, Romans 12. Lord, I give you my body. I'll just sing three chords first.
Be still and know I'm God. I will take care of you. Your burdens I will carry. My love I'll give unto you. Let me know. See you through. Trust in
in me, and you will see the love I have for you. Lord, grant now a restful spirit, full of joy and peace to share, born of hope, mercy, and kindness. We are gracious, forgiving, and fair. Bold, triumphant, we serve Christ. We love others and ourselves the same. Marching together, one body, His word will be proclaimed. Marching together, one body, His word will be proclaimed. Lord, I give you my body. I give you my mind, not just my emotions, not just my time. You gave me your body, you gave me your mind. I receive them freely, I now make them mine. Jesus, name above all names, worthy to be worshipped, worthy to be praised. Image of the Father, radiant in light, you uphold us with your power, you defend us with your might. Jesus, you're my Lord, my brother and friend, forever and ever, world without end. I serve you freely, day by day. I love you madly, every way. Jesus, name above all names, worthy to be worshipped, worthy to be praised. Image of the Father, radiant in light, you uphold us with your power, you defend us with your might. Heaven is my home, forever I'll stay. Stay right beside you, and love you always. Come live inside me. Come make me your home. I need you desperately, so come, Jesus, come. Jesus, name above all names, worthy to be worshipped, worthy to be praised. Image of the Father, radiant in light, you uphold us with your power, you defend us with your might.
Amen.
Amen.
I think we're done, John.